For the why can I not make words? Why no words? Why are the words not mouthing and stuff? Greetings and welcome to Reckoned Opinions, because making pop culture top 10 lists is a hobby, but pointing a camera at it is content creation. Brave new world, folks. My name is Adam, and I'll be your host today as we dive into our ongoing list, ranking every single song to hit number one on the Billboard Alternative Charts in the 1990s, ranking the worst to first, 145 all the way up to number one. This is part seven, which means that there are six prior episodes. If you haven't seen them, I'll stick some links down there in the description. You know where to find them. We do have a few new subscribers this time around. Welcome aboard. If you haven't subscribed yet, if you knew how many takes it took to get to this point, I'm leaving that in. If you haven't subscribed yet, do click the subscribe button down there. Click the like button, leave a comment. All of that really does help a lot. It helps the YouTube algorithms to catch up with us. You know, they never call, they never write. Faith in nothing. Get up, restless. We are just below the halfway point on our charts here, and that means that the dark days are way, 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 way behind us. We've gotten past the yuck, we've gotten past the meh, we've gotten past the and we've gotten into the I'm gonna call this episode Here we go, number 85. So here's a topic that we haven't really discussed at length yet, and that's the topic of soundtracks, how the use of a song on a soundtrack will affect airplay and how much the song sells. Now, most of the time when filmmakers want to include pop music, they choose something already existing, something that they already know is going to fit their mood, and they just license that. But sometimes they ask the band directly for something, and that's what we're going to talk about here a little. That can go in a couple different ways. They may ask for something that is very topically specific to the movie at hand. So there will always be that tie-in between the two, and you can't really separate them completely. They might also offer a cover tune because A, it's familiar, and B, they don't end up burning off an original that's not even going to be on their own album. Or they could just hand in a song that they already recorded for another album but didn't release and say, we're going to call this a new song, we're really just clearing out the closets a little bit. But regardless of which of these is the case, it stands to reason that the more popular the movie is, the more popular the song is. Yeah, that's enough of that, thank you. But the two don't necessarily correlate to each other. I mean, just ask Billy Idol off of his song from the hit movie The Adventures of Four Fairlane, R.I.P. Oh, another example? We're taking our first dip into Lake Green Day, the body of water that some 41 would one day draw their bathwater from. We'll be hearing plenty more from these guys, but with a band this influential, any song that comes along, we have to evaluate it as to where it fits into the continuum of their career. Which is unfortunate, because when you're discussing the continuum of Green Day's career, you're probably not discussing J.A.R. J.A.R. was the big single off of the soundtrack for the 1995 film Angus. Show of hands for everybody who saw Angus, not seeing a lot of hands. Maybe that's because I'm staring at the back of my iPhone strapped to a stand, but the point still stands in all of that. It was a track that they had originally recorded for their mega, 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 mega smash album, Dookie. They left it off for whatever reason and then sent it on to the film's producers for the show. And so we're looking at a non-album track from a flop movie, and it doesn't fit in with the band's continuum, the continuum of their career. It's like their career is going straight line, straight line, blip, and that blip is J.A.R. And you can't really evaluate it in terms of what else they've done. So I have to put aside Dookie. I have to put aside American Idiot. I have to put aside Woodstock 94. I have to put, there isn't even a video for this thing to talk about. I am forced, I tell you, to evaluate this song on its own merits. I did not sign on for this. Green Day are the biggest of the big names in the 90s punk revival that brought us bands like The Offspring and Rancid, but it might actually be better to lump them in with Nirvana, another band that took an aggressive music form and gave it its own little pop hook shizzle. Like punk, this song is quick in and quick out. This is not a genre to stand around asking you how your cat's doing.
I'd like to get in, get on with it, get it over with, and get out. Get it?
Got it.
Good.
But Green Day's still willing to play with the form a bit. That bouncy opening bass line is like an overexcitable Pomeranian greeting you at the door. And the closing vocals are like barbershop quartet for the California Robitussin crowd. Starts small, goes big, ends small again. It's like an entire workout playlist in under 3 minutes.
And then you have Billy Joe Armstrong, who's kind of a rarity for a punk vocalist because he actually hits the notes. Like, that's important to him, and that's fantastic, but it doesn't make sense when they put him so low in the mix. It's like they stuck him behind the amps or something. And I have to wonder if maybe he was just really hungover that day and just kind of like, guys, I don't have it. Could you just turn down my monitor, kind of make everybody else louder, and coffee. Coffee's good. Black, please.
But even though we can ignore where J.A.R. falls in this band's continuum, we can't ignore that that continuum exists. And that's where the questions start popping up. Why was it left off Dookie in the first place? Why did they shunt it off to a B-level James Vanderbeek flick? They eventually put it on their Greatest Hits collection, but why is this song forgotten, unlike Basket Case and some of their other big hits? We're left with the impression not of a Green Day track, but a Green Day knockoff. The sort of thing a TV showrunner would grab when they can't afford the licensing on the real thing, by some band calling themselves Greenish Morning or something.
J.A.R. stands for Jason Andrew Relva, which is the name of a friend of Mike Dirnt's who died in a car crash when he was 19. So this isn't a throwaway song. This is something that's very personal to them, and also proof that they can create a sad song that is also both angry and celebratory at the same time. And I can't get past, though, the fact that it feels like a footnote. I mean, this would be a curiosity if it weren't so them, you know? And the fact that it is so them is why it ranked as high as it did. But I can't put it any higher.
There's plenty more Green Day on its way. I mean, these guys were all over the charts like Dior Sauvage for a while. So I'll hold off on my enthusiastic gushing until then. For now, we just got this song. The little brother sent in the big brother's place. Glad to see him, but when's the big guy getting here?
I wanna make a plan for a day far away. While I'm young and while I'm able, all I wanna do is...
When in doubt of which drugs to take, why not take them all?
Say hello again to Perry Farrell. Activist, humanitarian, organizer, environmentalist, fundraiser, visionary, and founder of Jane's Addiction, a band whose music sounds as if a farmer's market and a meth lab had a child.
I made a point of starting with his good points, because Perry Farrell had his demons that he hadn't conquered yet in 1990. His demons specifically being speed and heroin, which were the salt and pepper shakers of 90s recreational pharmacology. And I'm not saying that those demons are why they made this song. I am saying that it's probably why they didn't do something else.
Let's start with the lyrics. Actually, no, let's start before the lyrics.
Nosotros tenemos más influencia con sus hijos que tú tienes.
This is hands down the second best 90s party jam by men with a spoken word intro by a woman speaking Spanish.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and motherfuckers.
The lyrics themselves are a little hard to grasp, partly due to Farrell's nose goblin delivery, and partly because I'm not really sure there's any there. Stop is kind of about the environment, but also kind of about partying with a side of, your guess is as good as mine. One come a day, the water will run. No man will stand for things that he had done. Hope we all are taking notes on this. It's kind of like John Doe's diary in Seven on a day when he had just gotten a good haircut. So that's the lyrics, but the music is where it really gets interesting.
So I opened this segment with that take all the drugs at once crack, no pun intended. Shut up. I opened with that because this song is the closest musical experience I've had to being in a drug addict's head. And I think that's largely because it's not static. It cycles through the entire medicine cabinet, depending on what the person took last and who's running the MP3 player at the party.
The first notable feature is that pedal-to-the-metal guitar line, an anxiety attack with an amp. It's got both structure and propulsion, the chassis and the engine all wrapped into one. I always assumed that was a cocaine thing until I read Perry Farrell's history, but speed makes more sense on this one. Cocaine motivates you to hit all the bars, while speed motivates you to make a list of all the bars you're going to hit. But then it gives way to a whoa, kinda trippy, rolling on E section that sounds like it's really into back rubs right now. Then there's that a cappella pullback bit, we'll call that the bong rip of the evening. And of course, the contractually obligated pause when he yells stop.
The energy of this track is infectious and it's engaging, little exhausting, but what eventually starts to lose me is the chaos of it. There's chaos as artistic statement, and there's chaos because that's where your life happens to be at, and we're looking at the latter at this point. And that sort of thing from a narrative standpoint can be compelling and interesting, but it's not comfortable to be around. If you've ever been at a party and you're the only one who is not high as balls, the people around you don't make you feel any more compelled to break out the heroin spoons.
Farrell did indeed conquer all those demons. And he did a lot of work to help recovering addicts get to a better place. Stop as a song is vibrant and kinetic, really wants you to get in the car and go for a ride. And I understand the appeal, but mostly it makes me want to wait until the hangover's gone.
That's closer. We'll give it another shot here. Take three.
I got a bad disease.
I have to assume that regular viewers are sick unto howling death of listening to me talk about down-tempo Red Hot Chili Peppers, because I'm sure as shoe leather sick unto howling death of doing it. I made the mistake of making some gross generalizations on the first one because, well, you know, it's a YouTube video, and now I feel like I have to elaborate on that until people actually understand what I'm talking about. My issues are not with the Chili Peppers turning down the energy knob, it's with them turning down the energy knob and then leaving the room.
Like J.A.R., Soul to Squeeze was a hit song from a flop movie. In this case, the movie was Coneheads. Show of hands for Coneheads.
What would you like for consumables? Pop-Tarts, chicken embryos, seasoned patties of ground animal flesh?
Still back on my phone, but we'll go with it here. Also like J.A.R., it was a song left off of a hit album. In this case, Blood Sugar Sex Magik. They did release it as a B-side to Give It Away, and then again as a B-side to Under the Bridge, so they were really gunning for this to work. And funnily enough, it does work. It works better anyway. And I think that's because it sounds more like we expect what the Red Hot Chili Peppers are like in real life, which is to say, friendly and really, really baked.
The band hands over their 90s alternative credentials right off the bat with a guitar part that I can only describe as South Cali Wonderwall. And then the drums come in what I can only call a shamble, a sound that advances forward like a barefoot parent trying to get across the playroom without stepping on any Legos. And then there's Anthony Kiedis' vocals, laid back, not pushing too hard. We've caught Anthony after the first, but before the second cup of coffee.
It took away my pain, simply.
And again, longtime viewers can hear this and reasonably think, hey, this is exactly what I was bitching about on My Friends several episodes ago. But there's a crucial difference here.
So guitarists have a number of different postures that they can use. They can be standing, and that's generally used for stage performances and when you're rehearsing with a band. They're sitting, but you know, directly over your guitar so you can hear what you're doing and remain focused on that. And that's for more intense practice, you know, maybe practicing with somebody else, but more likely by yourself. And then there's couch guitar. Couch guitar is when you're all the way back, you know, possibly over the arm of the couch, and you got your guitar here, which you're not really paying attention to. Have you ever seen like a music documentary and you get that scene in the green room where the guitarist has a Fender Stratocaster with no cord and he's talking to the groupies and not really listening, but he's still plunking along like he can hear it even though there's no amplification whatsoever? That's couch guitar, and that is the vibe that this song brings. And the thing about couch guitar is that it may seem low in energy, but that's because it's putting the energy not into the song itself, but into the moment. And that's not necessarily a bad thing.
It feels weird to say, but what Soul to Squeeze gives us is the warmth from the Chili Peppers that we didn't know we needed. This is post-gig Chili Peppers, or even patio barbecue Chili Peppers. They don't crank up the juice because now is not the time for juice cranking. It does ramp up for the middle eight, like patio barbecues so often do. They're not going off-piste, it's just, well, it's time to grab another Natty Light out of the cooler.
You know, low-octane Chili Peppers still isn't my jam, and probably isn't going to be, but if you're going to do that, this is how you do it, because it's chummy, you know, it's like a funky softball game. It's a compliment, I promise.
We're not done talking about the Chili Peppers on this countdown, but I think we're finally done with picking on them. So, onward and upward.
If the 90s had only started a year and a half earlier, this would be a completely different show.
The Billboard Modern Rock charts first debuted on the week of September 10th, 1988, and the number one spot of that very first list was held by Peekaboo by the legendary Susie and the Banshees. A song that was angular, vibrant, cutting edge, unlike anything else on the radio at that time. And if the 90s had started at that point, I would have the uncommon pleasure of being able to talk about it with you now.
But instead of that, we've got this.
You can't understate the band's importance as icons in the history of goth, but Susie and the Banshees were more than willing to evolve with the times. So when 90s alternative hit, they were more than ready. The only question that remained was I ready for them?
So preparing for this, I took a look at the list of number one songs on the alternative charts before the 1990s, you know, that little 16-month gap between September 88 and the end of 89. And those number one songs are a rogues gallery of incredibly important formative listening experiences for me as an up and coming music lover. The songs that are the reasons I listen to alternative. 89 was a more formative 90s year than 1990 was for me. It had Pictures of Matchstick Men by Camper Van Beethoven, which I still think is one of the greatest covers of all time. It had Veronica by Elvis Costello. It had Channel Z by the B-52s, which I always loved more than Love Shack and everything that came after that. It had Mayor of Simpleton by XTC. It had not one, but two songs off of Green by R.E.M., which I had bought on CD and played the ever-loving hell out of. And in that whole wave, I think Peekaboo might be my very first alt-rock thing. You know, the first one to get through the force field and into my head and really shape my listening habits. So when Susie and the Banshees did their follow-up, Superstition, which came 3 years after Peep Show, I was excited and I listened to Kiss Them For Me and I really liked it. But when I came to do this list, I hadn't listened to that song in ages. And I still listen to Peekaboo on a monthly basis. So what happened?
Kiss Them For Me doesn't sound much like anything they had done before. Neither did Peekaboo, but this is a different sort of different. The entire operation is pinned on that Indian raga sound, coupled with that electro psychedelia that would beat the trip-hop community to the punch by a few years. Especially in that breakdown section, which is far and away the best part. They also seem to have leveled up a bit on production. They'd always been studio-friendly and willing to build up some pretty dense arrangements. This isn't dense, it's downright lush. The sort of sound that should come with a complimentary packet of Hyacinth Salt Scrub. All of this is capped by the unmistakable voice of Susie Sue, sounding not unlike the president of the Kate Bush fan club at karaoke night. only better.
I think it's the lushness that keeps this song away from me. The thing about Peekaboo is that it was very, very astringent, very immediate, very nuts and boltsy. I mean, they could have recorded it by banging wrenches on an 86 Camaro and gotten the same thing. Kiss Them For Me, on the other hand, is very grand and stately, and that's impressive, but it's over there. I'm looking at it from across the room, and I just can't get close to it. I'm not going to sit here and say that it's overproduced. I don't think it is, but it's not what I'm looking for from these people.
If we measured the decade of the 90s as starting in 1988, then Peekaboo would have been in the top 10 of this list, hands down. But all we do have is this song, and it's a solid number 82 with a bullet.
Actually, you know what? Let's play a little more Peekaboo. Thank you for your indulgence. Carrying on. So, funny thing happened on the way to the taping. This day is not
my life. In the category of running jokes that stopped being funny months ago, here we see me kvetching about 90s attempts at 80s era Molly Ringwald alt pop. You know, music you dance to kind of like this. We burned through about 9 of these in the bottom 30 of the list, and on the surface level, House by the Psychedelic Furs fits in with them perfectly. What's this? We're just below the halfway point. We're well into the not that bad section. I feel like mall security. You don't belong here. What are you doing in this part of JCPenney?
So let me give you a little background on how this project has been put together. I started by doing my initial ranked list of all 145 songs. If people are really interested, I can do a little side video on my methods for doing that because it's a lot of fun. And then there was the nipping and tucking section where I would go through and go, what the hell was I thinking? Why is this so high? Why is this so low? And moving things up and down. Not too much of that because things got pretty close the first time around. And so the first time I ranked these, House ended up like really close to the bottom because I didn't remember it very well. So I kind of lumped it in with all the other 1990 stuff that I didn't really care for. I think it might have even been in the bottom 10. But because I didn't remember it well, I went back and listened to it again, and it moved up a little bit. And I went back and listened again, and it moved up a little bit. And again, like at least 4 iterations of this. I'm as baffled by it as you are.
We open with a guitar lick that's about as store brand as you can get. Could be 80s, could be 90s. Like Schrodinger's Jangle Pop. Luckily, it gets settled before the verse even kicks in. Yep, it's 80s. Boy, howdy, is it 80s. Keep expecting to look over my shoulder and see Andrew McCarthy and Jamie Gertz making out in the rain in matching jean jackets. Then the bridge kicks in. That's when everything changes.
The bridge is why House is ranked as highly as it is, because every time I picked it up, I could not put it back down. And this is another dancing about architecture moment because I don't know why that is. I don't understand it. I do know that this song has something that other similar songs lack. I'll be damned if I can tell you what it is. Windows of my room, I
hear the traffic breathing slowly. Maybe it's the way the chords lean into that emotional upswell. That feeling catching up with and then overrunning the superficial cool of it. Maybe the bridge is actually the missing link between the 80s and the 90s. The sound of the alternative revolution happening in real time. The sorrow in the lyrics is a particular 90s sorrow, self-deprecating and not inclined to go quietly. It's the kind of sorrow that the likes of Candlebox and Sponge would eventually embrace. And the line that the song is built around, shame will shake this house. That's the linchpin. Pull it out and the song collapses, well, like a house.
I think this song reached the ceiling of how high it was going to go in the rankings. There's too much shared DNA with a bunch of other 80s holdover songs, the ones I sit here and say, it's on the wrong list and it should never have happened in the 90s and all that. But I can't deny that there's magic there. Just a little bit. It might just be a few bars, but those few bars levitate me clear off the floor, and I can't not acknowledge that.
So is that it? Are we finally done with 80s holdover Britpop? Not quite. Not just yet. Real question is there anything good enough to actually reach the upper echelons of this list? No spoilers.
Why don't I hate this?
It's the second time up for the Cranberries, as well as the second time in this episode when I've had to explain why a song ended up as high as it did. Zombie is like the Cranberries went out of their way to create a song that I would hate with every fiber of my being, and yet somehow, some way, I don't. If you knew how long I stared at my notebook trying to find answers, you'd understand why this video was so late this month.
When we talked about the Cranberries before, I mentioned that Dolores O'Riordan has what I called at the time a controversial voice, but I didn't go into detail about where I stood on that controversy. I also mentioned that I didn't care for them all that much at the time, and I didn't really give my reasons why. And it was partly I just didn't care enough, I just didn't engage with it enough, but it's mostly, and I really hate saying this, it's mostly because of her voice. And I'm sorry, fans, this is me talking. I can't say anything else other than that. So when Zombie comes out, it sounds like Adam said, "Hey, Dolores, stop that." And Dolores said, "Oh, you want me to do something else, asshole? Well, here we go."
I had a pleasant and enjoyable time trying to think of snarky analogies for that vocal flourish. Let's see. Yoko Ono with the hiccups. A yodeler entering a fugue state. A DJ scratching an album of dial tones. A baby ostrich with its head stuck in a pony keg. Trying to get a Volkswagen Beetle to the shop for an overdue brake job. Me trying to hit the high notes. Just keeping it real here. What I'm saying is that this little detail should send me right out the door. And yet beyond all reason, I kinda love it. Because whatever else is going on with it, this is a vocal trick that's working for its paycheck.
Zombie is about what's euphemistically called the Troubles in Northern Ireland. And this would be an appropriate place for a history lesson, and I don't have it in me right now to do that. But the specifics that you need to know about this particular song is that it's about an incident in Warrington, England, when two boys were killed by a bomb that the IRA had planted in a rubbish bin. And at the time that it went off, the band were in a tour bus and not that far away from the incident. So this hit very close to home. There's a lot of anger and grief in this song. And that vocal tick that we're talking about, it's doing a lot, if not all, of the emotional heavy lifting on this. It's unsettling and abrasive because it needs to be unsettling and abrasive. You know, you can make jokes that it sounds like an air raid siren. That's because it is. And it is because it has to be.
Behind O'Riordan, the rest of the band strips the song down to street racing specs and then revs the gas. This is a four-chord song, but it's not the usual four chords. It may be repetitive, but it's not inviting you to get comfortable with it. And the grind never stops grinding, so every time O'Riordan deliberately misses a landing, it leaves a little crater behind. Their tanks and their bombs indeed.
This is a difficult song, no matter how you slice it. It is specifically designed to rattle your nerves, and I have a limit to how much I want my nerves to be rattled in any given moment. But I would be lying if I said that this weren't an incredibly effective song. Any song about the Northern Ireland Troubles has to be a gut punch, and by God, they delivered.
The Cranberries were never anything other than sincere, but it was always a quieter, more familiar sincerity. And for the band that made their name on songs like Linger to have this be their most lasting legacy, that's a true testament to this song's lasting power. Yes, it's a hard listen, but maybe it's a necessary one.
You really want to know what 1995 alternative sound like? Then get up, grab your Pog collections and your George Foreman grill, and then sit back down again, because it's not that exciting. Even though the moment passed me by.
yet another repeat artist. I've already talked about Goo Goo Dolls' transition from punk to pop. It's a metamorphosis that didn't happen overnight, but arguably name is when it stuck. If you're in a rock band and you pick up an acoustic guitar, you have just made a capital C choice. Break out the map because that was your left turn at Albuquerque.
This really is the sound of 1995 alt-pop. It's like they crafted the platonic 95 alt-pop ideal. It is completely on the nose. It is so on the nose that I was a little shocked when they started having more hits. It's like, what more do you have to say on the subject?
If I were doing an edu-webinar on 90s alternative, I could deconstruct this song like a toaster. Starting with that sound. The secondhand Barca Lounger chords, the camel filter rasp, the burning roach tucked behind the strings at the bridge of the guitar, the slightly outgrown shag haircut hanging in the eyes. Okay, you can't actually hear the last two, but they are strongly implied. And then there's the lyrics, which thematically at least are on point. In the gap between Gen X frustration and Gen X apathy is the world of Gen X lostness. The place where you ask, what the fuck do I do now, and there's no answer coming. But we have a problem.
And the problem is that Name indulges in the old trope of the poor lost girl. I mean, picture Manic Pixie Dream Girl, only she's an HGTV fixer-upper project. You know the sort of thing I'm talking about. And you can get away with that maybe if you're presenting it as a character study and nothing else. But as soon as you put yourself in the narrative, you're a douche. You are a douche because no matter how good your intentions, you become the quote sensitive guy unquote who goes after strays with low self-esteem because they don't run away fast enough. So signal to you songwriter bros out there, repeat after me. Look at me. Repeat after me.
Trauma is not a dating profile. You're not being sensitive, you're being predatory. Knock it off.
The song is actually about MTV Alternative Nation host Kennedy, who Johnny Resnick was dating.
It's as good as the sweat from the Christ child's brow.
That line about, I won't tell no one your name, that's actually literal, because Kennedy's first name wasn't public knowledge at that point. That mitigates things a bit, knowing that it's about somebody and not some rando at the bus stop. And Resnick mitigates it further by making it clear that he too is lost and broken. He's not trying to play the hero role. And that does make me feel better both about it and them, but I still have to consider what the impact is on someone who doesn't have the Cliffs notes. And in that capacity, the song still makes me itch.
So like I said, absolute textbook mid-90s alt-pop, but textbook examples tend to be the starting point, not the finishing point. So this song is baseline. It's not apotheosis. This hand signal means apotheosis. Are you with me on that? Can I put my hand down now? Thanks.
If I'm being honest, I'm sure this song represents a sincere attempt to work through some emotional truths that he was facing at the time, which makes it doubly unfortunate that I have the associations with Name that I have. I like it well enough as far as that goes. I just wish I could stop picturing a guy gesturing for a woman reading on the train to take out her earbuds.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay, go on. Okay. One hit wonders, my nards.
You know, the whole one-hit wonder thing is a thankless pedantic battle, so I'm gonna get this off my chest and then we can move on. It's true, Forgotten Years did not reach the Billboard Hot 100, but come on, man. This is the second Midnight Oil song to appear on this countdown, which I'll remind you is a countdown of number one hits. And neither of the two songs is Beds Are Burning, their ostensible one hit, which by the way is another alternative number one from 1989. God damn, that was a good year. Okay, shutting up on this topic, let's get down to brass tacks, shall we?
So their song Forgotten Years is like Beds Are Burning, their ostensible one-hit eye roll, and also like Blue Sky Mine, see our last episode, in that it is a protest song because Midnight Oil is gonna Midnight Oil. But it's worth mentioning by way of contrast that there's two types of protest songs out there, the general and the specific.
The specific protest song narrows its focus down to a particular person or event or an especially narrow issue, while general protest songs are about the broader subjects, equality or hunger or the environment. So for example, Biko, about Steve Biko, the slain anti-apartheid activist, is a specific one, whereas War, which is about, well, war, is a general one.
Now, Desert Burning and Blue Sky Mine are both examples of specific protest songs. Desert Burning is about the taking of Aboriginal lands. Blue Sky Mine is about asbestos farming in Vietnam. But Forgotten Years is a general protest song because it's about peace. It's about peace and how it's the younger generation's job to bring peace about and make sure we never forget what the earlier generations have paid to get there. But there's a specific challenge, ironically, to writing a general protest song, is that how do you keep from turning this into, golly, everything sucks, and nothing more than that? It's like, you're presenting the problem, that's great, but what do you do about it?
The hardest tears, the darkest tears, the roaring years, the fallen years.
Peace songs have a proud tradition, but they come with a whole separate set of challenges. They tend to come in one of two flavors, either boo war or yay peace. Boo war tends to be the angry one, while yay peace is a little more upbeat, even downright schmaltzy. Forgotten Years is the rare peace song that actually manages to straddle the two. The lyrics are very much boo war, but it comes with a yay peace attitude. They took the simmering soup pot of positive hippie sentiment and stirred the urgency back in.
So my problem with Blue Sky Mine was that there was a disparity between the lyrics and the music. They just didn't fit together for me. There's a little more of a fit here in that Forgotten Years knows that it wants to be an anthem. It answers that question of what do we do about this by creating community. And this is a song to be shouted at the top of your lungs at the pub with a pint in your hand. But there's still a disparity because Peter Garrett does not know when to turn down the vocabulary knob, and it ends up sounding like slam poetry set to guitar pop. It's like, if you want all the people to be shouting along with you, they need to know what it is they're shouting, Peter.
Well, it aches like tenements. It reads a politics.
The main reason for this song's middling rating is that it doesn't quite stand out in the crowd enough for me. The message is good, the music and lyrics are fine, but it needs a little oomph, needs a little je ne sais quoi. I feel like someone just handed me Marvin Gaye's What's Going On and I said it needed more cowbell, but that's where I'm at right now, so...
The Dead Heart, number 53 on the Hot 100. Dream World, number 16 on Alternative Airplay. King of the Mountain, number 20 on Mainstream Rock. Truganini.
I said it's the hardest years, the darkest years.
Hang on just a second. Okay, now I'm ready to do this again.
Four times. This is the fourth time I've had to talk about U2 in this damn series. I am rapidly losing credibility when I say that U2 is one of the greatest bands ever. By nature of this being a countdown, the songs do get better as we go, but what about everything that I peed on to get here? I had to Irish up my coffee back there, not because U2 is Irish, but because by this go-around I'd really much prefer a few cookies and a nap. Really, my only way forward is to pretend that none of that ever happened.
So, U2, band we have never covered before. I will honor the subterfuge if you will. The Fly, like the rest of Achtung Baby, sort of represents a new start for the band. Not so much with the lyrics. The lyrics are kind of disposable. It's meant to be a bunch of Instagram-type aphorisms being spouted by... He's playing a character who is pretending to be wiser than he actually is. If you've ever seen Bono in Across the Universe...
We're aviators. We're eating taters. Masturbating alligators.
That's basically the guy he's playing in this song, which, fine, whatever. So that's the lyrics. Musically, Lord, have mercy on my sinful soul.
Because first the Edge lays in that thrusting codpiece of a guitar line, and then Bono starts whispering at us like we're about to either fuck, blow up a power station, or both. I'll be in my bunk. Now, if they'd just seen that particular line through to the end, this song might have made top 30, but Bono just couldn't help himself. Oh, honey, no, please, no. I'm sorry, I have to call it. The date's over. The rideshare will be here in 10.
I am not saying that Bono can't do falsetto. I'm not saying that Bono shouldn't do falsetto. He's actually really good at it, but there's a time and a place, and you need to learn the time and the place, and this is not the time, and this is not the place. This is like that friend that you have to explain to them, yes, blowing a spit bubble with cigarette smoke in it is a really great trick, maybe not on the first date.
Even the rest of the band kind of backs away musically, like they know they have to let the big guy get it out of his system first. The song does manage to hang together more or less. The production is like wet cement between the electric spaghetti mixdown and the hey, what does this button do guitar effects. But like wet cement, everything that hits it sinks in and anchors itself, becomes part of a solid structure. You just have to be really careful about what you're tossing in there.
This is one of those quandaries that I'm running into a lot as we near the middle of the pack, because like a lot of songs, it starts off great and then goes weird. So how do you rate that? Do you upvote it because of the good stuff? Do you downvote it because of the bad stuff? This is a case where the two halves balance each other out pretty well. So middle of the pack is really where it belongs. But I still want to shut it off after the first minute and just give them the benefit of the doubt for the rest of it.
And no, I'm not done with you two, because you two certainly isn't done with me. Stick a pin in it. We'll come back around sooner or later.
As I said, we are nearing the halfway point. So it's time to break out the big guns.
God, how do you even begin talking about something like Nirvana? The legend was massive even when they were still recording. And then that legend grew to the size that they reserved for Abraham Lincoln and David and Goliath. Nirvana crammed a massive amount of legacy into the small box that was their time together as a band. And that right there, that's why we're discussing About a Girl in the first place.
Nirvana only released 3 studio albums during their time together, and that's not the smallest discography out there, but it is a fly speck compared to the size of the ocean of their influence and importance. And because they only had 3 albums worth of material, and because the public hungers for more Nirvana songs, and let's face it, because the studio hungers for that sweet folding grief cash, they released their MTV Unplugged show as an album and the unplugged version of About a Girl as Kurt Cobain's first posthumous single. And to describe it that way, it makes it sound like it's a footnote, and I think that undersells it, because it's not a footnote, it's a footnote of a footnote.
It sounds like it was never meant for radio, because honestly, it wasn't. I don't know if the Unplugged gig would have been released as a CD if Kurt had survived. I do know that when putting together their Unplugged set list, they steered away from the major hits. So, no Smells Like Teen Spirit, no Lithium, no Heart-Shaped Box. Instead, they favor tracks like About a Girl, which was an album track from their debut CD, Bleach, an album that never achieved much more than underground success during its initial release. And the band knew full well how much not a hit it was. You can tell by how Kurt introduced it.
This is her first record. Most people don't own it.
And so here we have an acoustic live version of a non-single from an underperforming album in a concert that was never meant to be released, and now it's a number one hit. If you leave behind a vacuum, the universe will find a way to fill it.
In a way, it kind of feels like they backed into this. It's almost like a reverse demo. You know, it's not the lo-fi direct-to-tape version that they record before they can do the real version in the studio. In this case, they did the real version, and now we're going to do the acoustic version for an audience that doesn't know the difference. And I am glad that they're able to expand the audience for this song, because it's a great song, And I even know why they chose it as a single, because on Bleach, it was the one pop song on a non-pop album. The legend is that Kurt Cobain listened to Meet the Beatles on rotation for several hours, and this song is what burst out of that.
But there's two things standing in the way for me, neither of which is the song itself. First is that this is not the ideal presentation. Unplugged is loose and ragged by design, and if they wanted to get the most ears possible on this song, there are better ways to do that. And the other is just the sheer crassness of it all. This is a young man who took his own life because he felt he couldn't meet the world's expectations for him, and the world responded by trying to meet those expectations with whatever he left behind. It's like going through his pockets at the wake looking for loose change.
Nirvana gave one of the greatest MTV Unplugged performances of all time, and About a Girl is a good chunk of the reason why it's that great. And I know it's presumptuous and kind of rude to assume that I know the intentions of somebody who's no longer with us, but for me, this song, as great as it is, at best it comes off like an album track, and at worst it sounds like a TV performance. I like it. I'm just not sure I want it.
I try to picture what Cobain's reaction to this would be, to how they rushed this to stores only 6 months after he passed. The dismissive headshake, the dismissive gesture. That's the life of a rock star for you. Oh well, whatever. Never mind.
And thusly, we come to the end of yet another episode of Reckoned Opinions. Thank you so much, as always, for spending time with me. If you got a second, click the like button. If you got 2 seconds, click subscribe. If you got 10, leave me a comment, and I look forward to hearing from you. I am going to go turn on the air conditioning and let the cat out of the bedroom, but I will be back with the next episode, part 8. Yes, hitting the halfway point. Hitting the halfway point in the next episode. I can't wait, because, God, this is lasting forever. In the meantime, thank you again. Stay safe, stay healthy. I hope all is well with you and yours. And in the words of Jane's Addiction, I'm going to wait for the cat food dispenser to stop because it's screwing up my sound. And the problem is that I have a frog in my throat. That's a problem. That is a big problem. I don't like that problem. Okay. One hit wonder. I seem to have feelings about that.